Okay, good afternoon. Thank you for coming along. My name is Dirk Schubotz, and I'm the director of the Young Life and Times survey. So I've been responsible for running the survey of 16-year-olds since 2003. And co-presenting, although my co-presenters are absent today, can't be here, unfortunately, together with Katrina Lloyd, who is the director of the Kids Life and Times survey, and Martina McKnight, who is our researcher who we work with. And the purpose of my talk today is to talk about sport and the experience of young people and showing young people about physical activities in Northern Ireland. I will give a little bit of background information about the survey and the study. I will present some key findings. And then I've been thinking about recommendations, policy recommendations. What if I could recommend one or two things that could or should be done? So, and I think I've come up with a couple of things which are easily done, not expensive, and would improve the situation in relation to physical activity and sport in Northern Ireland. So, Kids Life and Times and Young Life and Times were already partially introduced. So, Young Life and Times is an annual survey of 16-year-olds. We use the Child Benefit Register to sample our 16-year-olds. So it's we know now that for about 4 years, the better off young people in Northern Ireland don't receive child benefit anymore. But in principle, it's an almost universal benefit that's being paid out to everybody who raises children and young people in Northern Ireland. And even those who are not in receipt of child benefit are still registered with HMRC. So we have a very good sample and take a random sample every year. To include children and young people. Kids Life and Times is much easier because it's a census of all P7 children. So every P7 children, whether they go to a mainstream school, a hospital school, a home school, or whatever, is being invited to take part in the Kids Life and Times survey, which is an online survey. Young Life and Times is a postal survey, but we provide opportunities for the young people to complete online or over the phone if they wish. Most complete on paper, and I'm happy to discuss that later on as well, because there'll be some people who might be surprised that they do. So in 2015, which is a data set that I'm referring to, we got funding from Sport Northern Ireland to run some questions on both of the surveys, Kids Life and Times and Young Life and Times, on young people's and children's experience of sport. And this table here shows that we had 1,556 respondents, 1,156 respondents in Young Life and Times, and we had over 5,000 respondents in Kids Life and Times. So these are reasonably large samples, and they represent the whole of Northern Ireland. Okay, the response rate was 23% for Kids Life and Times, 27%, so just about a quarter, over a quarter of all schools took part. And the response rate for Young Life and Times was 31%. So one in three, basically, who we invited took part in the survey. So I turn my attention to the actual questions, which are on sport and physical activity. The first question we asked is what children and young people did every week. And that's a multiple choice question, because they don't do just either PE or sport outside school. So that's why the figures here don't add up to 100. And you can see, if you pay attention first to the bottom row of the data, that we have 5% and 8% of, I need reading glasses, 8% of 16-year-olds, but 19%, that's almost one in five of the P7 children, who said they didn't engage in any sort of physical activity of the ones that we listed, which included walking or cycling to school, doing PE in school, activities outside of the school context, and any other physical activity, and that included, for example, children who lived in rural areas, helped out in agriculture or domestic work at home, gardening, or things like that. Something that, made them sweaty, really. Physical activity that made them sweaty. So you can see that a reasonably small proportion of 16-year-olds, but a much higher proportion of KLT respondents said they did nothing like that. We did ask children, young people, for how often during the week they engaged in at least 60 minutes of physical activity or sport in a day. And that is sort of the activity target, if you like, that is being set by policymakers. And that's supposed to be the sort of the healthy target, the minimum that everybody should do every day. And again, I want to look at predominantly the bottom row, but also the top row first. So you can see here that 9%, so that's 1 in 10 approximately children, said they never did that, and no day in a week. They had at least 60 minutes activity. And that could have been broken down into sort of running for 20 minutes on the schoolyard and running again 20 minutes at home and things like that. So it didn't have to be necessarily 60 minutes in a row. It had to be 60 minutes in total. And 1 in 10 P7 children said they didn't do that on any day. And the proportion was very similar, in fact, identical for young life and times respondents. Again, 1 in 10 said they didn't do that. But if you pay attention to the bottom row, and again, this presents the findings by gender, we can see already a big difference here. So we can see that it was 37% of the males, of the 16-year-old males, but only 27% of the 16-year-old females who were active to the sort of ideal amount of time during the week. So 7 times a week, 1 hour at least, or more. Okay, and for KLT children, the proportion was much smaller, but the gender difference was even bigger. Okay, so we only have 5% of the females, so that's 10 or 11-year-old children, but 10%, roughly 10%, 1 in 10 of the males, 13% of the males at that age who were active to an extent that policymakers would expect them to be in order to be healthy and have positive outcomes. So it already is quite clear that there is a gender difference emerging in relation to physical activity. Okay, so when I looked at that by school type, perhaps it is the type of school that they attend that makes a difference in relation to physical activity. And we could see here that really for the children who attend primary school, P7, school type did not make a difference in relation to that. So, okay, well, it's about 1 in 10, regardless of what school you went to as a P7 child, who never had the level of activity that is required. For young life and times respondents, the difference was that was different. And you could see that those who attended grammar schools were significantly less likely to have not the requested amount of activity, so at least one hour a day. You know, one of the ways to have activity, of course, is PE in school, physical activity that everybody gets. And you can see here the difference was that In young life and times terms, you know, those who attended grammar schools were twice as likely as those who attended planned integrated schools or formally integrated schools to have PE every week in school. So some differences emerged at post-primary level, but the primary level, there were few differences, really. I want to look more closer at the gender differences now. And I start off with the Kids Life and Times survey. So those are the P7 children. And I looked at different types of questions, and I show the questions here that were gender differences emerged. The first one is the question on whether or not they cycled or walked to school. So the light green color are the males, the dark blue color are the females, and you can see that there's a slightly higher proportion of males who walk or cycle to school when they're at P7. Okay. Significantly, and the second column shows that males at P7 age are much more likely to be encouraged by the family to be physically active or to do sport. So that really is a highly significant difference. And we see from that perhaps traditional gender roles are enforced, that boys are being sent to sports club to do sport and be encouraged to do sports, whereas girls are not. Okay. We also asked for role models of whether they are encouraged by famous people or other people to be physically active. And the KLT survey shows that females were much more likely to don't have a famous person as a role model. Half of them said they didn't, compared to 41% of the males. And more importantly, you know, 57% of the females said that they had no role model, and only 34% of the males said the same. So there's a really significant gender difference already emerging at that age. Now compare that with the gender differences at young life and times. So there were slightly different questions. We asked more questions of young life and times respondents. And the first difference that emerges, and I've already alluded to that, is the amount of activity that 16-year-olds undertake. And it's very clear from the survey that males are much more likely to have the requested amount of activity in relation to 7 times a week, 60 minutes a day. Okay, 5% of females, 13% of males. But you can see that the females are actually, it's not because the females are not interested in sport. Okay, so the second column shows that they're much more likely than the males to say they would like to do more. Okay, so there's a real difference emerging here in terms of what is available in terms of facilities and so forth for males compared to the desire of females who want to do much more. Twice the proportion of males said they want to do more physical activity. Competitiveness is one thing that comes into mind, how important competitiveness is. And that's important in relation to how we organize the sport and the physical activities for children and young people. You know, and males are much more interested in competitive sport. I had a discussion with my 12-year-old son about that, you know, this is what sports is about. And I said, well, not necessarily. You know, there are people who do physical activity in sport and don't necessarily want to win all the time like you. So there's different elements of that, as the survey data shows. Okay, but also in relation to the role model of the sports idol, and we can see here again, similar to the KLT, that males are more likely to have a role model in terms of physical activity. Gender differences for young living times. So this is also other questions in relation to being tutored to be physically active, being involved in coaching programs themselves, being involved in squat programs, or being trained to be like an elite athlete, if you like, taking part in community relations programs which involve sports activities, and the desire to be involved in community relations program that involves sports. And you can see the gender differences are stark in all of those cases. Okay. Males are getting more, essentially, females want to get more of it. So it's very obvious from the language times. We did ask about the types of activities that they're involved in. Again, I differentiate between the children and the young people. And that gives us information in relation to where we perhaps should invest into sports facilities for young people. Kids Life and Times, football came out first. You know, that was the activity that most were involved in. You know, so. But also, and you will probably be surprised to see that running was the second most important activity for them. So that is already, you know, football is very much an organized sport. I mean, you can play at the, you know, the back of your house or on the street or on the sport, you know, on the green field if you like, if you have that available. But often football is an organized activity, whereas running doesn't have to be organized as such. You know, it can be a very individualized activity. And we saw that emerging already in kids' life and times. I mean, there are now the likes of the park runs and the children's park run and so forth, where children can take part, the junior park run. But we were surprised to see that. But generally speaking, a very wide variety of activity. When we look at the 16-year-olds, you know, the individualized sports activity come to the fore much more than for the P7 children. You would perhaps expect that. So walking was the activity that they're most involved in, that they did most. Football is still important, but it's of secondary importance compared to walking and running. So again, the individualization came out as evidence from the study. I'm looking now, coming to the conclusion here, but I want to look at the enjoying of the physical activity. I mean, there's no question that physical activity in sport is healthy, and that investment in sport and activity at this point has benefits later on, and we know that. I don't need to repeat the arguments. But it's also important that children and young people enjoy the sport that they are involved in, and this table shows that they do predominantly. So PE for Kids Life and Time survey is often the activity that they have, okay? And 82% say that they enjoy this a lot, you know? So, but also sports outside was enjoyed by over 3/4 of the children at P7 age. And Barry McElduff was talking about activities, outdoor activities. Rishi was still here, could see that, you know, before he cuts down the funding on the activities centers. Outdoor activities are crucially important, and I wish the decision today will be that they don't cut, and the kids enjoy it. They do enjoy it. Okay. Young living times. Okay, PE is much less important and much less enjoyable, and you will probably expect that. You know, partially it is because it's not on offer anymore, and the tech, for example, or if other subject areas are prioritized. But you know, Adventure activities are important and enjoyable, and so are physical activities which are not organized by school. And the evidence shows that very clearly a very small proportion of young people, fewer than 1 in 10, do not enjoy these activities. Okay, what are the prohibiting factors in relation to that? Not enough time for 16-year-olds. I mean, those of you who have children or, you know, remember school will know that when you're 16, a lot of other things are prioritized. So it's making time for sport, which is the issue for 16-year-olds. Part-time jobs, boyfriends, girlfriends, cinemas, loads of homework, stress for 16-year-olds is very clear. And they don't seem to have the time to make sport. So we need to think about making time for it because it is so important. For P7 children, the question is slightly different, okay? And you can see here in the third row from the bottom, I don't know where I can do the activities. It's a fact that P7 children often don't find out themselves where to do things, where they can do them. They rely on the parents, and parental support is very important. Last question before I come to the recommendations is the people who inspire them. For P7 children, the sports idols are really important, the Ronaldos, the Messis, and they're the ones that came out. But more so for boys than for girls. At 16, this has worn away, and people realize that the inspiring people are the people that manage to fit in physical activity in their everyday life. The family, the brothers, the sisters, the friends, they are important, okay? Family, 59%. So it's really important from the family point of view. That's why they're finding on KLT that family supports boys but not girls to be physically active is such a significant finding from the surveys. I talked about the health benefits, and the children and young people are aware of the health benefits, both at P7 age and the Young Living Times respondents knew that sport has benefits for the physical and mental activity. Mental health perhaps is a slightly lower proportion amongst KLT, but it's not because people think, the P7 children think it's nothing to do with mental health, it's just because maybe a lack of awareness. So it's a 10% who say, I don't know, who make the difference between the KLT and the YLT here. So generally, children and young people are very well aware of the mental and physical health benefits that sport has. The more physically active they are, the healthier they feel themselves. So self-perceived health is directly and very significantly related to the amount of activity that they undertake, as this figure shows. The more active they are, the healthier they feel. It's very clear. Same for Young Living Times. Okay. If you're physically active 7 times a week to the at least an hour or more, sometimes 2 hours or 3 hours a day, as some young people do, they have an excellent health. They feel that they have an excellent health, and the data show that very strongly. So what are we going to do about this? Okay, and I'll come to the final slide here, the policy recommendations. It is very clear that there are mental health and physical health benefits for children and young people, and as Gemma alluded to earlier, with aging, the benefits will be reaped whenever we get to an old age. That's very clear. So the investment has to be done now in order to have benefits later on. And one of the easiest things to do is to invest into physical education because it doesn't discriminate between females and males. Everybody gets physical education. We know the family encourages males more to be physically active than females. In PE, we don't find that. Everybody's doing it. Investment should be done in PE. Scotland and England have statutory PE education at post-primary and primary level. There is no reason at all why Northern Ireland shouldn't have that. No reason. Lastly, we can see from the survey that females are less interested in competitive sport. Walking, swimming, cycling, these are the activities that they're doing. Females are the ones who are least active. They are the ones who will have the greatest problems unless we address that in later life. So we ought to have infrastructure in place that suits females, which is non-competitive, easy to access everywhere. Walking paths, cycling paths, things like that. Thank you very much for your attention.